So in the last video about the forces that create local or alpha diversity, the kind of species richness that we find within plant communities, I ended up by talking about randomness and stochasticity and the fact that the local community is actually linked with other communities in this surrounding environment, what we call the gamma diversity. And this is basically by seeds being dispersed on the wind and something called seed rain, where the seeds fall into the community. And so stochasticity, randomness, is a part of community assembly. And my idea was to come here today when there was a storm. In fact, I was actually looking for bad weather when I came, and this morning it was really, really bad weather, with the idea of catching a kind of storm event, a really windy moment when the seeds are likely to be dispersed. And the other thing is that, as you've just seen, a lot of plants are now starting to produce fruits and seeds. So we're really getting into the period when we can start to see seed dispersal. Unfortunately, I missed the lightning, I missed the thunderstorm, which is probably just as well because many botanists die from lightning strikes or coconuts to the head. And I've decided to talk about something else that I brought up last time. And I want to carry on with the topic of ecological filtering, because that depends a lot on individual genotypes, genetic diversity, because communities are groups of populations, and populations are groups of individuals. And individuals, especially if they come from sexual reproduction, which in fact we're seeing in most of the species that we have here, populations are made up of genetically distinct individuals which have their own characteristics, the kind of outward expression of the genotype, which we call the phenotype. So when species are filtered to create the plant community, it's actually the individuals that are being filtered. The individuals are being selected. Some individuals are fit for the local environment and others are not, and they die. This selection is especially active for seedlings, for young plants, and it's usually only a very few individuals that get through to adulthood to reproduce. So essentially, what I'm going to show you now is that within one species, there are individual genotypes which we see as different phenotypes, we see as different forms. And although this is a concept that we can apply to any sexually reproducing species, it's particularly evident to the naked eye for some species. So what I'm going to talk about now is valid for all of the sexually reproducing species here, but I'm going to take one particular species, which is Neotinea tridentata, so this orchid that we've seen a lot of at this grassland. Now, there are some characters of organisms which are kind of fixed and they define the species. And there are other characters which are variable from individual to individual. And Neotinea tridentata shows this really, really well. So Neotinea tridentata, it means three-toothed, because the labellum, the landing platform for the pollinators, because this has three main lobes. But one of the features that really stands out about this orchid is that three of the tepals, the petal-like structures at the top of the flower, form a kind of hood for the pollinating insect, and they end in a kind of canine tooth. So when you look at the orchid, each flower kind of has like three little teeth that stick up. And then there are characteristics which change from individual to individual. And so I'm going to show you some photographs now of the plants from here, the individual plants from here. And don't forget that these photographs are of individuals that are growing within a few meters of each other. So even though they look very, very different, they are from one local population. They're not from northern Italy, southern Germany, or something like that. And what you can see is that the form and the size and the coloration of this labellum is strikingly different between individuals. Now, for the orchid, there's actually a good reason for this, because it's one of these orchids that doesn't provide a nectar reward, so it uses what we call a food deception pollination mechanism. So the insects see a flower which has the right colors, it's the right size for the insect, and they come along, but then they don't find a nectar reward, so they pass on to another flower. Now, if that other flower is exactly the same, Insects are not stupid. They'll recognize that it's exactly the same. They can understand that there's no nectar reward, and they wouldn't go to it. So if that flower is slightly different, it still has the correct cues for being a flower that they can get nectar from. It still has the right colors, more or less the right shape, but it's slightly different, then they will accept it as a place where they can search for nectar. So in order to guarantee pollination, the flowers of Neotinea tridentata have to be slightly different from one another, and that represents individual genotypes being expressed as the phenotypes. Okay, fine. So we have a population in which the individuals are expressing a range of different phenotypes. That's very pretty, lots of nice pretty flowers, but why is that important? What does it tell us about the plant community? What does it tell us about the ecosystem? So thanks to British ecologist Philip Grime, we know that having a range of individual genotypes in a population increases the stability of the plant community. And what I mean by stability is that within that plant community, it's less likely that a particular species will go extinct locally. So a stable community is one that retains its species, and an unstable community is one that loses species. And when you lose species, you lose capabilities, you lose possibilities. Maybe there's a particular flower on which a particular pollinating insect is dependent for food, and then you lose the insect, and then you lose the birds because they have no insects to eat, and okay, so a stable community is one that retains its plant species and all of the other species that depend on them. So what Grime did was to create what we call microcosms, so recreating plant communities using individual plants. And he did this in two ways, in a comparative way. Some of these microcosms were made with essentially clones. So for each particular species, the individuals were divided vegetatively, creating genetically identical individuals. And then other microcosms were created using plants that had been collected at different points in the wild, so they were genetically different from one another. And what they found was, essentially, the communities that were made from sexually reproduced individuals, genetically distinct individuals, tended to retain these species over time. So some individuals would die out, but there would always be some individual representing the species. In comparison, the microcosms that were made from genetically identical individuals tended to lose species and so become less stable. So there's a very important lesson here. The genetic variability of populations, the range of individual genotypes, is important to plant communities and then also to ecosystems because it confers stability, and stability means that these ecosystems are resilient to changes.